An analogy is a comparison argument. It compares the features of two items or ideas to show where they are sufficiently similar to use one as an explanation for the other. Analogies are powerful and useful because they help us make connections between the familiar and the new. Joy, my sister-in-law, once asked me what it was like to bungee jump. I said, "It's a bit like the rush of an extreme roller coaster without all the banging around." I was comparing something Joy understood with something she didn't understand. I was making an analogy. The analogy requires the recipient to make inferences that may or may not be valid. We've all heard the caution to compare apples to apples. The axiom implies the importance of using relevant analogies. If the comparison is valid, comparing apples to apples, so to speak, then the analogy is considered valid and useful. If the comparison is not valid, comparing apples to something else, then the analogy is considered faulty. Using a faulty analogy on purpose is a fallacious form of reasoning. We are accustomed to making and accepting quick comparisons that enliven speech and frequently make a new point clear. Metaphors and similes are the literary devices used in this way. They tend to be simple, brief, and easily understood as representative of an idea or point that is not being stated explicitly. They are so frequently used that it's not uncommon for teachers to point out their value and encourage their use. Analogies are a bit like extended metaphors. They use the known and understood as a means of explaining the unknown or new. Unlike metaphors and similes, though, they work with complex comparisons. And the more complex the analogy, the more likely it will not work to fairly and accurately explain the concept being argued. Some of the bits from the original example will not work at all to explain the new way the original example is being used. That can be a problem if those bits are related to significant differences. However, no analogy is a perfect fit with another. So there will always be at least some differences that can be pointed out between the comparisons. The problem occurs when the analogy has too many differences, or the differences are too significant that it is not presenting a fair interpretation of the new idea. Some faulty analogies devalue the impact of the original comparison. For instance, when a person's home is robbed and the person says, "I felt raped," that comparison devalues the much greater impact of an actual rape. In a similar way, the frequent comparison of U.S. political leaders to Hitler diminishes the impact of what Hitler actually did, as well as unfairly maligning those whose actions come nowhere near those of Hitler. Let's take a look at a valid use of analogy and an invalid use as a way of better understanding what analogies are and how they function in an argument. Arguments favoring legalization of marijuana frequently use the analogy that marijuana prohibition is like alcohol prohibition of the 1920s. It turns out this is a very workable analogy. During prohibition, a large portion of the population did not agree with the law banning booze, so many people broke the law. This is true of marijuana use today. Even though it is illegal at the federal level and in most state jurisdictions, millions of Americans break the law. Crime increased in response to the desire for alcohol. Minorities and the poor paid a higher price for breaking the law because they were arrested more frequently, and some had to work in the illegal industry when there were no legal jobs available. Again, this is true for marijuana, and there is significant gender discrimination in policing as well. Consider these statistics revealed by studies of data between 1998 and 2007. In New York, 374,000 people were arrested for marijuana possession. Nearly 90% were male. About 83% were Black or Latino or other people of color. Nationwide, 74% of arrestees are under age 30. 94 million Americans acknowledge having used marijuana. Nearly 20 million Americans have been arrested. 89% were arrested for possession, not sale or manufacture. A percentage of people became addicted to alcohol, but most didn't, regardless of the legal status of alcohol. The number who become addicted to marijuana is significantly lower, according to a Federal Institute of Medicine study in 1999, fewer than 10% of those who try marijuana ever meet the clinical criteria for dependence, while 32% of tobacco and 15% of alcohol users do. By comparing the significant facts about prohibition with facts about marijuana, it's pretty easy to see that the two situations are similar enough to warrant comparison. An example of an analogy that does not work is when Bryant Gumbel compared treatment of NBA players to slaves. Slaves paid nothing, lived in poverty, they were beaten or killed at will by owners, their families were split apart, their children sold, they were treated with contempt in society. NBA players, the lowest paid in 2011-12 was $490,180 a year. The highest paid was $25,244,000 a year. They live in luxury. They are often protected from consequences of bad behavior, and they are treated with deference and admiration in society. It would be virtually impossible to make a valid comparison between the lives and situations of NBA players and slaves. And there are other analogies and metaphors that simply have not worked, such as when Hank Williams Jr. inferred Obama was like Hitler. The differences are too many and too extreme to make the comparisons legitimate. It's important to remember that analogies will always have differences. No two situations are exactly equivalent, so we have to be cautious about calling an analogy false. However, the more similarities there are, the more likely the analogy is to be useful and valid. Always ask yourself if the comparison can legitimately be carried out far enough to make the comparison useful.